very important topic, that is temporomandibular joint disorders. But if you see the question papers or for the BTS level, what we were taught, the most important things that you have to remember is the classification, MPDS and imaging. So I'm restricting my lecture to these three things. Okay. So first is the classification of TMJ disorders. Now, first is the disorder abnormalities of the cranial and mandibular bone. So they are of two types, developmental and acquired. Developmental like aplasia, acquired like neoplasia. Second is another component of TMJ. Okay, so the TMJ disorders per se in that mechanism. So there's disc displacement with or without reduction, dislocation, inflammatory conditions like synovitis, capsulitis, arthritis, and ankylosis. And the third category is masticatory muscle disorders, in which most commonly asked and very important for you is myofascial pain dysfunction syndrome. So we'll go to this, we'll deal this in detail. What you have to remember, it was named by Laskin. It is also known as Costin syndrome. It has multifactorial pathogenesis. Diagnosis is based on symptoms and signs in absence of radiographic changes. So there's no radiographic changes. Generally, a psychophysiological, you know, psychosocial theory is given for its occurrence. It has a very unpredictable natural course, and the patient might tell you that they have an episode of exacerbation and regression. It has been very potently correlated with the stress, and people have described that there's a vicious cycle which takes place, which leads to MPDS. So patients who are very high strung or have anxiety and stress generally have parafunctional habits. This causes excessive strain on muscles, which again causes muscle fatigue and pain. This could be exacerbated if the patient has certain malocclusion, occlusal trauma, or jaw injuries. So because of this muscle fatigue and pain, an imbalance occurs, you know, in neuromuscular complex. And it also is the reason for the chronicity of the disease. And this again leads to more anxiety and stress. So this cycle goes on. And why I want you to remember this cycle is that when we manage, our aim is to break the cycle at one point. So when we discuss its management, you will realize that either I can take care of the anxiety stress, so I can break the cycle here, or parafunctional habit ke liye, or it's, you know, the muscle fatigue and pain ke liye. So we have to decide in the patient, tailor make the management for each patient, ki kahan pe interrupt karna hai, kahan pe intervene karna hai. So that is the key of successful management of MPDS. Okay. So what are the symptoms? Chronic, poorly localized, intermittent, dull aching pain, restricted mouth opening, clicking sound is present. Patient might also complain of morning jaw stiffness and weakness of the masticatory muscles. So what are the signs? Tenderness over the joint or muscles of mastication. The most commonly involved muscles of mastication is masseter or lateral pterygoid. Characteristically, there is presence of trigger point in muscles. There is reduced mouth opening and there could be jaw deviation or movement. So what are the things that are present? Restricted mouth opening, clicking, right? And tenderness, presence of trigger point. What is missing is the localization. And second is any radiographic changes. So these are the cardinal signs, positive and negative signs of MPDS. And how do you manage MPDS? As I told you before, you have to see the cycle and where to break it. So first is for the psychological aspect, you should do the patient counseling. You can use physiotherapy, which requires, you know, hot, moist compresses or coolant sprays. Jaw exercises against resistance is very, very important. To alleviate the pain, analgesics can be given, ibuprofen, or you can do topical application of counter irritants like capsaicin or piroxicam. They have been used very, very effectively. Then you can use anxiolytic and muscle relaxant with due caution. You have to say that the patients do not get used to it. So you can use diazepam 5 mg tablet at bedtime for 7 to 10 days just to alleviate the stress. For trigger points, you can use local anesthetic injections. If you feel there is some parafunctional habits, the patient shows, use habit-breaking appliances, repositioning devices. If there's some occlusal corrections to be done, do that. You can also try transcutaneous electrical nerve stimulation or TENS, which has been successfully used for these patients. And another very important thing is biofeedback. So remember, MPDS, I have to break the vicious cycle. So if you remember the cycle, you will be able to write the management. All right? Prognosis is still unpredictable. Another question that comes very commonly is the TMJ imaging. Now, TMJ imaging is divided into conventional and the advanced imaging modalities. In conventional, lateral skulls, reverse term, and whatever what we know as TMJ projections. Very important, I have changed the font color. Transcranial, transorbital, and transpharyngeal are very commonly asked, and you must know them. The other imaging techniques are panoramic radiography, arthrography, CT, and MRI. So these are the three TMJ projections in specific. Sometimes they are asked in the technique. I will not go into the details of technique. It will take a long time to do this. So I suggest you to read it from White and Farrow. What is commonly asked, and I want you to must remember, is the indication and area of joint seen in each one of these. So indications of first, that is transcranial view, is the TMJ pain, internal derangement, only for seeing the bony structure changes and range of movement of joints, because it is done, you know, open close. So area of joint seen is lateral aspect of glenoid fossa, okay? Then articular eminence and the condylar head, and you can also appreciate the joint space. Transpharyngeal view, again it is indicated for TMJ pain dysfunction, for arthritis and pathologies like condylar head, cyst and tumors, fracture of neck and condyle. Area of the joint seen, you can see the lateral view. You can see the condylar head and the condylar neck, and you can see the articular surface. So any morphological abnormalities can be detected in this. It is also known as infracranial view or the mapping del view. Coming to transorbital, I always used to be fascinated with this view, you know, how you direct it from the orbit and to the, you know, contralateral TMJ. It's also known as a Jimmer projection. It is peculiar and many a times asked in MCQ because it is the only TMJ view which gives the anterior view of TMJ. Okay, and you can see the median and lateral pole of condyle. And it is very, very useful in trauma and fracture cases because it will give you an idea of the medial displacement of fractured condyle and fracture of neck of condyle. So remember these three views. But apart from this, now because of time constraint, I cannot cover everything. But you also must know these terminologies. They have been asked once or more. One is DD of Prismis for short notes. Please read it. Then radiographic features of osteoarthritis. Just remember the terminologies. Osteophytes, elicyst, joint mice. And for rheumatoid arthritis, pencil-shaped condyle. And what is injuvenile? Toadstool appearance. These are important from MCQ and Viva. Imaging modalities, you should know other modalities also like MRI and arthrography. Generally, it just comes as enumeration. You should know that bird facies is seen in ankylosis. You should know what is click, what is crepitus, and what is reciprocal click. For example, reciprocal click is seen in anterior disc displacement with reduction. And you must know from practical point of view, examination of TMJ and muscles of mastication. So I have just shortlisted the topics which you must also know. All right. So now coming to the last part of my presentation, that is oral manifestation of systemic diseases. So I'll be covering diabetes mellitus, HIV, and anemia. Now, what are some tips? Now, you just must think that I'm just giving tips, but actually this is rapid revision and I am just sharing how I studied for OMR during my BDS, or, you know, we used to go to our seniors and just tell them, please take what is important. So I'm going in that direction. So one tip that I want to share is generally short notes and MCQs are asked on specific appearances and investigations in cases of systemic diseases. You must know the oral manifestations of diabetes mellitus, HIV, and anemia. In this, iron deficiency and pernicious anemia in particular. Leukemia, oral manifestation has been asked once. Then Plummer-Vinson syndrome, Peutz-Jeghers syndrome, hemophilias, thalassemias, the radiographic features. What are the definition of petechiae, purpura, and ecchymosis? Radiographic features in hyperparathyroidism and polycythemia vera. Generally, MCQ comes, ruddy cyanosis is seen in 4 options. The right answer is polycythemia vera. So I'm just giving you a very exam-oriented picture of frequently asked questions. But again, to emphasize, these are frequently asked. Not necessarily these will be asked for your exam. So coming to the very important and what we have been, you know, studying every time, what are the oral manifestations of diabetes mellitus? So proposed oral manifestation of diabetes mellitus include burning mouth syndrome, candidiasis, dentinal caries, periodontitis, and the entire list is there. Sometimes you might be asked why, you know, exacerbated periodontitis occurs in this. So the cause of increased susceptibility to periodontal diseases is because of these reasons. Alteration in host response, alteration in subgingival microflora. So it becomes, you know, the changes, the ecosystem has changed because there is more sugar content over there, right? So the subgingival microflora changes, which causes more destruction in the presence of same local conditions. Then altered collagen metabolism, decreased vascularity. As you know, the microcapillaries are hindered in diabetes mellitus and compromised neutrophil function. Because of all this, there is increased susceptibility to periodontal diseases in diabetes mellitus. This is asked. Sometimes Greenspan syndrome has come in the MCQ. So you must know what is Greenspan. So now actually they say that this terminology should be obsolete. Still for record and for history sake, Greenspan is a triad of diabetes mellitus, hypertension, and find out what is next. Just remember the name. Then coming to the next, oral manifestations of anemia, most commonly asked are iron deficiency anemia and Plummer-Vinson syndrome. So iron deficiency anemia, as you can see, I have marked with red. Characteristically, you will see mucosal pallor, atrophy of lingual papillae, atrophy of oral mucous membrane, and loss of normal keratinization, which makes it more susceptible to erosion and other things. It could be accompanied by soreness and burning of the tongue and angular stomatitis. Plummer-Vinson syndrome, as you all know, is a pre-malignant condition. It is characterized by dysphagia and microcytic hypochromic anemia. You will see a smooth and often sore tongue, dry mouth, choanorrhagia, and angular stomatitis, and characteristically dysphagia, which is caused by the cricothyroidal web. Plummer-Vinson has also been asked multiple times as SAQ. Coming to pernicious anemia, what you have to remember is the Hunter's glossitis, that is the fiery appearance of tongue in case of pernicious anemia. It causes glossitis and mucosal ulceration, and the patient complains of burning sensation, taste disturbances, and decreased salivation. For sickle cell anemia, radiographic features are important. So you see hair on end appearance, just like in thalassemia, but not as common as in thalassemia. Then you see the step ladder appearance of trabeculae and large irregular marrow spaces. Okay. Coming to oral manifestations of HIV, which is again very commonly asked, and I'm sure all the subjects have taught you this, but just for the revision, there are some more common diseases and some less common diseases. More common diseases include infections in this fungal, viral, and bacterial. The ones which are marked in the red are kind of pathognomonic for HIV infection. So pseudomembranous candidiasis, in viral infection, fulminant infection. So the severity is more in case of HIV. So you will see herpes simplex, varicella zoster, EB virus infection, including hairy leukoplakia. Remember, hairy leukoplakia is not a leukoplakia, it is an infection and is associated with HIV. Bacterial infection, HIV associated, gingivitis and periodontitis, necrotizing gingivitis, tumors, remember Kaposi sarcoma, short notes has been asked. So Kaposi sarcoma is there, and then persistent lymphadenopathy. These are the more common diseases. Less common diseases include infections like deep mycotic lesions, cryptococcus histoplasmosis, viral HPV and cytomegalovirus, mycobacterium tuberculosis, and Klebsiella infection in bacterial infection. Non-Hodgkin's lymphoma is a less commonly found oral manifestation of HIV, and then neurological diseases, paresthesia, facial palsy, and dysphagia. There are miscellaneous manifestations of HIV, which include recurrent acne, progressive necrotizing ulceration, delayed wound healing, purpura, and pigmentation. Now, all manifestation of systemic disease is a sagar. And what I have tried to do is to collect some pearls from it. But you will have to read it further. The best books to refer for this is Sonis, Kali, and of course our Bible, that is the Pearl Kit. So I'm sure you'll go back and read a little. But just for giving you some tips, again, some good to know facts. One is, ulcer in agranulocytosis will lack an inflammatory halo, and that differentiates it from other ulcers. You must know the characteristics of tubercular ulcers. You must know the management of patients with diabetes mellitus, von Willebrand disease. You must know angioneurotic edema for a short question. You must know small points like Bell-Jones protein is seen in multiple myeloma, generalized loss of lamina dura, osteitis fibrosa cystica, brown tumor is seen in hyperparathyroidism, chipmunk appearance, hair on end appearance, thalassemia, lantern jaw, hyperpituitarism. So the tip is that for scoring more, and you know, you should be very good at these, you know, the examiner is never going to ask what is normally present in everything. Pick up what is different from others. How I used to study, I used to go back to the index of the book and go on reading the terminologies. Acha, this one I know, and whichever terminology I don't know, read the, you know, the page number, go back and read from this. This is a very good way of preparing for not so long questions. Okay, coming to the last lesion, that is burning mouth syndrome. So is it burning sensation due to secondary cause? That is in the causes which are known? No, that is not burning mouth syndrome. Burning mouth syndrome, this terminology is, you know, typically used for burning sensation with no detectable causes. Clinical features, it is seen in females more than males, especially in perimenopausal women. And it is commonly seen in anxious and very high-strung patients. So there's a psychosocial connection or association which has been speculated, and it is commonly associated with xerostomia. Why I'm finishing it in one slide? Because generally you will get a SAQ. Management is to rule out underlying cause, patient counseling, and to alleviate that anxiety. You know, you can give low dose of TCAs like amitriptyline, but all this has to be done under supervision. So, because sometimes the patients get addicted to it, okay, or there could be abuse of drugs.